Now, I don't want to enter into that right now because I'm already in trouble with a lot of folk, but I really will get in hot water when I get on the divorce question, and we will get to it in the 19th chapter, and I won't avoid it then. But he makes it very clear there's only one grounds here for divorce. He causeth her to commit adultery, and whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery. Now, that means divorce that's not on scriptural grounds, which is adultery on the part of the other one. That is something that today is entirely ignored in Christian circles. But I say this will be the law of the kingdom, because there are going to be men and women will want to leave their mates during that period. Now he says again, you've heard that it hath been said by them of old time, that thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shalt perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it's God's throne, nor by the earth, for it's his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king. Now he said to be the kind of a person that you don't have to take an oath. Today they have people take an oath. I can remember as a boy that my dad could go into the bank and borrow money and maybe come back in 2 days later to see him just sign the note. And that's all he did, is just sign the note. He could call and they'd put so much to his account. I know that the other day when I went to the bank, I had to sign, I think, 4 different places. Believe me, brother, they have you sign up. Why? Because mankind's not to be trusted. And there were a lot in that day were not to be trusted. But he said, the child of God under all circumstances should be that way. And he says, let your communication be yea, yea, nay, nay, for whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. When a man says to me, I'd swear on a stack of Bibles a mile high, that's a fellow I don't believe, because I think the lie he's telling is a mile high. Verse 38, ye have heard that it hath been said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, that you resist not evil. Now he's changed all of that, and that'll be changed when he's reigning in the kingdom. But whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other also. How about that, friends? You follow that. Now there's a principle here, but we're living in a day when he also said, a strong man arm keepeth his house. And I think that's it. And Paul could say, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him. In the kingdom, you can turn the other cheek. It's like the Irishman. Somebody hit him on one cheek, knocked him down. He got up, turned the other, and the fellow knocked him down again. He got up, and he just beat the stuffing out of that fellow. Someone said, why'd you do that? Well, he said, the Lord says, turn the other cheek, and I did, but he never told me what to do after that. And he knew what he wanted to do after that. Now, verse 40, and if any man will sue thee at the law, take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asketh thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not thou away. Take that down to your bank, where you have a banker that says he lives by the Sermon on the Mount, and see how far you get with it, my friend. Let's quit being hypocrites. Let's be very frank, that this is the law of the kingdom, and when my Lord is on the throne down here, you can go by this. But this is a great principle today. We ought to help those, and I'm afraid that we don't do enough of that. Now he says, ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. That, I insist, is for the kingdom. Now we come in this chapter to see something that's very important, and it's the relationship of the subjects of the kingdom to God and the inner motives which govern external acts of righteousness. And here we'll see the giving of alms, prayer, and fasting, and the getting of riches. All of these are very important, by the way. And we see the relationship of the citizen of the kingdom of heaven to God. And you'll notice that when we concluded last time in chapter 5, and I rushed through that last section there rather hurriedly, we made the statement that business could not be conducted today by this law here. Archbishop McGee of Ireland years ago said that it was impossible to conduct the affairs of the British nation on the basis of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, I do not know whether I'm related to Archbishop McGee or not, but I certainly find that I think as he did about the Sermon on the Mount. This can only be enforced when he is on the throne. That, I think, ought to be quite obvious. Give to him that asketh thee, and for him that would borrow thee, turn not thou away. And so many of the wealthy churches today, they attempt to follow, they say, the Sermon on the Mount. That's their regular diet. Well, you go out and try to get something from the rich and see how far you get today, my friend. You won't get very far, I can assure you, because they don't really live by it. They say it's a great document. All they do is they just think it's great. That's all. They hear about it on Sunday. But Monday morning, it's just cold-blooded business and cash on the barrelhead, or you don't get it. And that, of course, is the way the business world is set up today. But there's a great principle here for the child of God, and we shouldn't miss that. We should try to be helpful to those that are in need. And there's so many kind Christian acts that can be performed today by believers. And after all, there were no hospitals or orphans' homes or works of charity. The Bible doesn't call it that. Acts of love that have preceded the preaching of the gospel, always followed it. And the proof, of course, is the fruit is the important thing. And there is a great principle here, and it concluded by saying that we're to be perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. And how can you be perfect? Accepted in the Beloved, in Christ. Those that are in Christ Jesus, there's no condemnation to them. God sees us in Christ. And you get there by faith in Him. That's the only way that you can become perfect, is through faith in Christ today. Then there begins that slow process of sanctification in our lives. And this, of course, should be a goal. But to say that you can automatically, in your own strength, attain it, and then go to God and say, look what I've done. Look how wonderful I am. And you get all the glory. And you force God to save you on that basis. And, my friend, you're going to do nothing of the kind, because you and I are not perfect. And it's only in the little nursery rhyme that the little fellow that reached in his thumb, pulled out a plum, and said, what a smart boy am I. We got a lot of that in religion today. The little folk that sit around and reach in their thumb and pull out a plum, and they say, my, what a smart boy I am. My friend, may I say to you, you and I need a Savior today. Now we're dealing here in chapter 6 with the externalities of religion. That's very important to see. In chapter 5, the king speaks of the righteousness which his subjects must possess. And it must be a righteousness to exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. Now they had a religious righteousness. And that man Nicodemus was an outstanding man. And he was religious. You can't find much to criticize about him, but our Lord said to him, you have to be born again. Now, we have to have a righteousness superior to that, and that only comes through trusting Christ. Now, in this chapter, he talks about the righteousness that the subjects of the kingdom are to practice. And the motive, of course, is an important thing in doing for God. No third party can enter into this relationship. These things are between the soul and God. And the things that are mentioned here are the giving of alms. The second thing is prayer. The third thing is fasting. The fourth thing is money. And the other thing is taking thought and care for the future. These are very practical.